I look forward to an America which will not be afraid of grace and beauty. I look forward to an America which will reward achievement in the arts as we reward achievement in business or statecraft. And I look forward to an America which commands respect throughout the world, not only for its strength, but for its civilization as well. And I am certain that after the dust of centuries has passed over our cities, we too will be remembered, not for victories or defeats in battle or in politics, but for our contribution to the human spirit.
From the John F. Kennedy Center for the Performing Arts in Washington, the 12th annual Kennedy Center Honors. A celebration of the performing arts, honoring Harry Belafonte, Claudette Colbert, Alexandra Danilova, Mary Martin, William Schumann. An evening of tribute and entertainment by their distinguished colleagues. Ladies and gentlemen, Walter Cronkite.
Good evening and welcome. Tonight marks our 12th Kennedy Center Honor Ceremony, an evening in which we celebrate the richness of the performing arts in America. On this night, when President Bush directs his attention to the business of world peace, we thank you, Mrs. Bush, for so graciously directing your attention to the performing arts. It was Leo Tolstoy who said, "Art is human activity having for its purpose the transmission to others of the highest and best feelings to which men have risen." Well, the five we honor tonight have done just that, given the highest and best of themselves. A musician from New York City's West Side, whose classical compositions resound with the sound of America. A Paris-born actress, whose performances on stage and screen blended the best qualities of European charm and American vitality. A ballerina in the grand tradition, whose journey began in St. Petersburg, Russia, at the dawn of this century. A singing, dancing sensation from deep in the heart of Texas, who went on to become Broadway's brightest musical star. A lad from Harlem, whose voice and spirit carried him to the highest reaches of the performing arts. A few hours ago, just a few blocks from here, the First Lady welcomed our honorees and offered them the nation's gratitude.
Good evening. And welcome to the White House. Someone once said that art is not an end in itself. It is a means of addressing humanity. Tonight we gather in this historic East Room to celebrate five Americans who have devoted their lives to art, and in so doing have enriched the lives of countless millions in this country and around the world. William Schumann, Claudette Colbert, Harry Belafonte, Alexandra
Danilova,
Mary Martin, how delighted we are to have had the pleasure of your company. You have taken us nearer to the stars and closer to the foot of the rainbow. And I speak for all America when I say thank you for sharing your best with us for all these years.
a 1981 Kennedy Center honoree, Jerome Robbins.
In 1939, when I was starting my career as a dancer, I was a modern dancer. And in those days, modern dancers and ballet dancers looked at each other with great contempt and great disdain, and neither believed that the other kind of dance was worthwhile. I was a modern dancer. And I went to the Met, and I saw Madame Danilova do Swan Lake. And it was a revelation. And I had to stop and reconsider everything because I realized that the classical vocabulary was a valuable instrument to be able to say anything you wanted to say in dance. So it changed my training, it changed my career, it changed my choreography, and it changed my life. When the time for her to give up her career as a dancer had come, she began to teach. There's a story that when she was filming The Turning Point, in which she played a ballet teacher, she came onto the set the first day, and she wore her usual practice dress, but she had a lot of jewelry on. And the director said, Madame Danilova, you look fine, you look wonderful, but I think maybe a little less of the jewelry would be apropos. And she said, not at all. You have to show the girls that it's worthwhile. She showed that it was very worthwhile for all of them. The Rose Adagio is a high spot of a ballet called Sleeping Beauty. And in it, four cavaliers each present to the princess a rose one at a time in the wooing her, courtship, and in admiration of her. And tonight I'd like to offer her four roses. And the first is for your career as a dancer, which was magnificent. Second, for your career as a teacher, where you brought us all the heritage of your knowledge of the Imperial School and everything since then. The third is for your choreography, which not many people know about, but which I find witty, wonderful. And the fourth one, Madame Danilova, is for you, and the pleasure and the treasures that you give your friends with your wit, your intelligence, your sensitivity. I take all those roses and I set them at your feet in a deep and reverent bow.
In the Russia of the Tsars. By the age of five, she was an orphan. The world of ballet would become her family. A classical soloist at the Mariinsky Theater, she became fascinated with the modern ballets of classmate George Balanchine. Revolution tore the country apart and brought an end to innovation. Balanchine asked her to leave with him for Paris. Russia was my home, she said, but dance was my future. The brilliant Sergei Diaghilev invited the avant-garde to change the face of dance. He asked Danilova to join the company, and she came to embody it. Suddenly, the ground collapsed beneath her. Diaghilev died, his company scattered. Balanchine left for America. Stranded and alone, she faced an uncertain future with one unwavering conviction. She belonged to dance, and nothing could separate her from it. She accepted minor roles until a new company made her its reigning star. With war threatening Europe, the company left for a tour across America. They headed for towns that had never seen ballet. Audiences came in curiosity and watched in wonder. This empress with the laughing legs was introducing America to ballet and planting the seeds of its future. One critic said, "She is the greatest of those who have the claim to the title of ballerina." The range of her roles was an endless delight. At the age of 54, she gave her farewell performance, and in her moment of triumph, bowed her head in reverence to her audience and her art. Quietly in retirement until an invitation from an old friend, said George Balanchine, "Perhaps you might help me teach the young ones how you used to dance." Every gesture, she said, must honor the art of dancing. Every new step is born out of mastery of the old.
From here, you should make arms softer, not like that. So it's like here. That's right, that's right. Okay, so we go.
"Life has been my art," she says. "It's privilege to be dancer."
Ladies and gentlemen, Jacques Dámboise.
Dear Madame Danilova, you have inspired countless audiences with your art, and you have also given to so many of us as a teacher and as a coach. And I treasure the suggestions and advice you gave me. After performing as the prince in Swan Lake, you said to me, "Jacques, very nice, very romantic. You dance like prince, but you bow like peasant." And then you proceeded to show me how a prince should bow with elegance and modesty. First, you have to say to the audience, "You." Not this way where your arm blocks your face. "You." And then you include all these people. And then look up. Don't forget up in the stars. And your leg closes. And you drop your arm, but not slowly. And not fast so it bounces. Just drop it. Now the bow, not like the actors do. Just look down. But if you did the right side, you've got to do the left. But if you did the right and if you did the left, you made the middle feel left out. So you have to do the middle. But if you're in a hurry to do the middle, people will think greedy for applause. So we have to do the ah shucks act. Ah shucks. Ah shucks. And then, only then, go as close to them as you possibly can and take them to you. And now for you, Madame, and for the audience, the pas de deux from Swan Lake. From the New York City Ballet, in the role of the Prince, Robert Lyons, and coached and advised by you, Madame, in the role of the Swan Queen, Darcie Kistler.